Hello. My name is Naomi Lowy, and I am the Deputy Director in the Division of Anesthesiology, Addiction Medicine, and Pain Medicine. With a new structure in the Office of New Drugs, our division is in the Office of Neuroscience in the Office of New Drugs in the Center for Drugs at FDA. In the next 10 minutes, I will share our division's current approach to the development of drugs and biologics for pain. Biologics are regulated in both the Center for Drugs and the Center for Biologics, and so my talk is limited only to those which CDER regulates. What I am sharing today is not official guidance or policy, and what I hope to do is to present my thoughts and ideas to spur further discussion. This is a challenging area of drug development, and while we are always looking at how things have been done, we are also open to how things could be done to characterize the benefits and risks of analgesics. FDA has committed to a number of priorities related to the opioid crisis. Among these are fostering the development of novel analgesic drugs and decreasing opioid analgesic exposure and preventing new addiction. Supporting development of non-opioid analgesics is a critical way to achieve these priorities, and one to which the division is committed and actively working with companies on their programs to support these. It is in this context that I present today. Let's start with some important basics. I start with the temporal definitions because although there is overlap in our approach and concepts to both, whether a company is looking at acute pain or chronic pain sets up the framework of their development program. Acute pain is defined as pain lasting up to 30 days, typically in response to some type of underlying injury, such as trauma or surgery. This definition of acute pain is consistent with the International Association for the Study of Pain's definition, in which pain is thought of as being of recent onset and limited short duration. The intensity of acute pain is greatest at the onset of injury, but the pain is reduced with healing. On the other hand, chronic pain is defined as pain that persists longer than 3 months or pain that lasts beyond normal healing time. Of course, there may be pain of a duration that falls somewhere in the middle. We can then start to think about appropriate indications. We can think about indications as falling into three main categories. First, a general pain indication. Is the drug expected to treat all or most types of pain? The second category we can call specific. Is the drug expected to only treat one type of pain? Does the company want to pursue a specific type of pain for other reasons, to differentiate themselves from other products? The third category we can call broad, and that is an indication somewhere in the middle. Since the first category I mentioned, the general pain category, is probably more clear in its scope, I've included examples here of clinical scenarios for the categories of specific and broad. Both acute and chronic pain are represented here. These are clinical scenarios which a sponsor may choose to pursue for a drug development program and an eventual indication. Some of these, such as pain from diabetic peripheral neuropathy and pain due to osteoarthritis of the knee, are real-life examples, while others may be hypothetical to give you an idea of programs that companies may pursue. You can see for the category of specific, there are potentially endless indications that target various scenarios. For broad indications, we would think about capturing categories like musculoskeletal pain, neuropathic pain, and post-surgical pain. All of these scenarios will guide the program and its requirements and will eventually impact the indication granted. The framework of acute versus chronic is important when thinking about the primary efficacy endpoint and time point. What is the best instrument to capture acute pain versus chronic pain? When and how often should pain be assessed in the trial? Another crucial concept is when does the drug begin to work? For acute pain drugs, this needs to be well characterized, and the time to onset should be reasonable for the proposed context of use. For example, if a developer is proposing an intravenous drug to be used for postoperative pain, many prescribers may have an expectation that the drug has a relatively quick onset of action, especially if there is no residual analgesia from the surgery. The important piece here is for prescribers to understand the time course. perhaps a somewhat delayed onset is acceptable in certain scenarios, as long as a prescriber can predict the onset and make sure that a patient has adequate and uninterrupted pain relief. The classification of acute versus chronic is also important because it dictates non-clinical requirements that would support a drug that is given acutely or chronically. Most of these indications will require at least two adequate and well-controlled trials. However, the number of trials may depend on a number of factors. As a sponsor seeks broader indications, these questions play into the number of trials that may be required. Is the drug from an established class, or is it a new molecular entity? Is there a related approved indication? For a broad indication, an NME may require more than two trials to understand if the drug is effective in all the relevant pain models that would fall into that broad category. Let's focus on acute pain and how to best assess efficacy. In general, the chosen primary endpoint should assess the change in pain using a period of time that is appropriate for the pain model that is used in the trial. Most typically, that is 24 hours or 48 hours, but other time points are possible. It is critical to consider the expected duration of need for analgesia. In certain pain models, pain drops off after 1 day, and some after 2 days, so an understanding of this is critical. And this may look very different for pain following surgery, and different for various surgeries, different for fracture. We have typically accepted the sum pain intensity difference, or SPID, as the primary efficacy endpoint for trials of acute pain. The SPID is calculated by multiplying the pain intensity difference scores at each post-baseline time point by the duration since the preceding time point, and then summing the values. This can be done over 24 hours, yielding a SPID 24, or SPID 48, which is over 48 hours. We have accepted the SPID 24 and SPID 48. Depending on the program and the details and expectation of the pain model, there may be scenarios in which consideration of other time points is appropriate. If a pain trial yields results that are statistically significant, is that enough? Does it matter if the effect size is tiny but statistically significant? We know that this is a challenging clinical trial space in which the placebo response is often great and that it can be challenging to show a treatment difference. So is the fact that any statistically significant difference is observed, is that good enough? That will depend on benefit risk. Let's think about a drug that has a small effect size but has a benign safety profile versus one with a small effect size but has concerning safety signals, especially compared to the standard of care. Here is a figure from a label of an approved intravenous NSAID. The primary endpoint for this trial was the SPID 24. As you can see, the curves separate, and the difference was statistically significant. However, in this study, which was an abdominoplasty surgery, you can see that early on there was a delay in the onset. The median time to patient-reported meaningful pain relief in this study was approximately 3 hours. For this drug, this characteristic is clearly described in the label. In fact, this drug carries a limitation of use statement that reads, because of delayed onset of analgesia, this drug alone is not recommended for use when rapid onset of analgesia is required. This information is required for the safe and effective use of this product. So the time to onset of analgesia is typically a secondary endpoint. We have asked companies to look at two patient-reported measures related to this. First, perceptible pain relief. When does the patient first feel any pain relief? And then second, meaningful pain relief. When do you feel meaningful pain relief? In order to answer these questions, FDA has accepted the two stopwatch method in which patients are given two stopwatches. Patients are instructed to stop the first stopwatch when they first perceive any analgesic effect, and they're instructed to stop the second when they perceive a meaningful amount of analgesia. And this is often translated into a description and labeling of median time to meaningful pain relief. There are limitations to this method. And while this has been accepted, we acknowledge that there may be alternative ways to assess time to onset of analgesia. In some cases, could the pain curves themselves help us understand when pain is being meaningfully reduced? So this is an interesting area of discussion. It's not a primary endpoint, but the data are critical. They not only relate to efficacy, but a delayed onset may become a safety issue. If a patient does not have adequate analgesia, they may require rescue medication. If the drug with the delayed onset is an opioid, what does a prescriber give as rescue? Another opioid stacked upon the first? This is a scenario in which safety issues may arise. let's pivot to secondary endpoints. As we've already seen, the primary efficacy endpoint does not paint the full picture. Secondary endpoints are important to characterize the benefit and safety of the drug. These data make their way into labeling so that prescribers can appropriately and safely prescribe. For drugs intended for the treatment of chronic pain, time to onset is less critical than in acute pain. Other secondary endpoints we often see are time to rescue, physical function, patient global impression of change. And precisely when these endpoints are assessed depends on the duration of the study, and so they are program dependent. Let's shift to the primary endpoints for chronic pain. The primary endpoint is most often based on the change in pain from baseline to the end of the study period, and 12 weeks has been an accepted primary efficacy time point. As compared to efficacy assessments for acute pain drugs, the summed pain intensity over time is not ideal for chronic pain drugs. There may be early efficacy that is not sustained, and therefore for chronic drugs, it is critical to see efficacy at the later time point. Comparing the average of the first week and the 12th week rather than the first day and the last day reduces the effect of daily variability. Daily pain scores are calculated into averages of the first week and 12th week. As analgesics for chronic pain are usually dosed around the clock and reach steady state concentrations of the active drug, time to onset and time to first rescue are not very informative. However, graphs of pain intensity over time, so-called pain curves, are often very useful to demonstrate the time course of analgesia throughout the study period and to provide a visual display of the difference between the novel investigational drug product and the control arm. For most chronic pain conditions, we have accepted either the numeric pain rating scale, or NPRS, and the visual analog scale, or VAS. For osteoarthritis, the division grants indications specifically for the pain of osteoarthritis. OA drugs that target the signs of the disease are handled by the Division of Rheumatology and Transplant Medicine. For the pain of osteoarthritis, we have accepted the WOMAC pain scale. WOMAC function and a patient global assessment have been accepted as secondary endpoints, which require replication to be included in labeling. Here is an example of pain curves for a drug intended for intra-articular injection for osteoarthritis pain of the knee. Here, the primary efficacy endpoint was the change from baseline at week 12 in the weekly mean of the average daily pain intensity scores as assessed by a 0 to 10 numeric rating scale. There are principles around trial design that apply to both acute and chronic pain trials. These trials are generally repeat dose, randomized, double-blind superiority trials. Historically, non-inferiority trials have not been accepted in this space, and that is because pain intensity can be influenced by study design factors, such as the use of rescue medication and placebo effect. A non-inferiority trial showing no difference between analgesic treatments could mean that neither product worked in that study. Therefore, superiority studies have been the standard. Suitable comparators for a superiority study could include placebo or another analgesic if the new product is expected to be more effective than the analgesic. Even if using an active comparator, a placebo is important for assay sensitivity. If using a placebo, an active control arm, usually standard of care, can inform the overall risk benefit. I would like to spend a little time touching on the approach to opioid sparing claims. It's a concept that is important, but when we label such claims, we must also be careful to be transparent in what is the actual benefit. So the concept of what level of opioid sparing is actually clinically meaningful. Is any reduction in opioid use clinically meaningful? Is there a specific cutoff, a number or percentage of morphine milligram equivalents that represents a meaningful reduction? Is a 10% reduction important? What about 50%? What about complete elimination of opioid use in a scenario in which it would be expected to be used? Is that clinically meaningful? If there is a reduction in use, not a complete elimination, is that reduction linked to a clinical benefit? So the takeaway here is that opioid sparing is not a catch-all term. We place a great deal of importance on understanding the actual benefit and describing that benefit in the label. Finally, a few words about our youngest patients in pain. The Pediatric Research Equity Act, or PREA, gives FDA the authority to require pediatric studies in certain drugs and biological products. The goal of the studies is to obtain pediatric labeling for the product. Pain clinical trials in the very young to continue to present a host of challenges. These include ethical challenges. It is not acceptable to allow a child to remain in pain. In our clinical trials, in adults often administer a drug only when a certain pain threshold has been reached. Another major challenge is how to measure pain in children, particularly infants. How is pain best rated in a child that can't provide their own rating? For drugs with an established mechanism of action, we have accepted extrapolation of efficacy for ages 2 to 16, along with required safety data, and we've required efficacy data from birth to age 2. For new molecular entities, we have required efficacy data from birth to 16 years. Some of the important questions for discussion are, when attempting to extrapolate, how do we determine comparable exposures? Do they need to be 90% comparable, 70%, 50%? What is appropriate for labeling? Should we label any pediatric data that are generated? If the data are inconclusive and we label them anyway, does that give the impression that the drug is indicated in that population? Is pure extrapolation without any efficacy data the best approach? Shouldn't we try to generate any efficacy data that we can? And how should we assess pain in the youngest patients? And some final thoughts. Analgesic drug development, particularly non-opioid development, is important yet challenging. Acceptance of certain approaches does not mean that we are not open to new and alternative ones. And answers to these difficult questions will require time, collaboration, and innovation. Thank you.